this at me.
I call this workshop for the Farmington School Board to order. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, first up, we have the approval of the agenda.
I'll make a motion to approve the agenda as printed.
Second.
Got a motion by Singwald, a second by Carrero. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye, and those opposed? All right, next up, we have public comment, and I don't have any requests tonight for public comment, so we will move straight into the consent agenda. And the consent agenda is made up of routine business items that can be acted upon with one motion. If any board member wishes to discuss an item, they may request that it be pulled from the consent agenda and will be acted upon separately. Does anyone have an item they wish to discuss? All right, hearing none, I will take a motion.
Move to approve the consent agenda.
Second.
Got a motion by Singwald, a second by Doyle. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. And those opposed? All right, moving right along, we will go into our work session discussion topics. The first item being the innovative learning spaces with a bunch of presenters.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, good evening, board members, Chair Cordes, Superintendent Haugen. You do have quite a few presenters, and I'm just going to kick it off just to kind of remind you what we've talked about so far and where we've been and where we are now. So, as background again, we had our bond projects come in under budget, and as a result of that, we had an opportunity to redesign some spaces to support our district strategic plan around personalized learning. So in May, there was a presentation by World Architects to talk a little bit about personalized learning spaces and give you an overview of what is going on around the state and region. And then we came back to you in May 22nd to ask for your approval to move forward with the planning for some of using 20% of the remaining bond dollars towards redesigning a space in every building. At the high school, we are looking at two, and in every other building, there's one. So then on August 14th, we had our Innovation Day. In June, we had our Innovation Day, but on August 14th, we came to present to you. We brought you four of those plans at the time. We had four groups kind of talk you through what it was they did in Innovation Day, and then also what their designs were at the time. And at that time, you also asked, will we get to see other spaces, and so tonight you'll see some other spaces. You won't have seen all nine by tonight. There are two schools that were unable to make it this evening to present, but you will see all nine by next week when, again, we'll come back to you to look at approving going out to bid for the nine projects. And so at that point, it will be less talking about spaces the way I do and more talking about spaces the way our director of operations and finance director do. So it would be a different kind of conversation at that point. But since we were here to do our presentation, there have been two rounds of follow-up meetings with the user groups and the architects. The architects went two different times and met with each group in each building to kind of refine the designs. And so tonight, the groups that are coming to you are going to kind of talk about what they've done since Innovation Day, so the refining of the plans, and then also have an opportunity to present to you what it is that they have designed. So as part of the fine-tuning of the designs, these are an overview of what it is they've been working on. They went into the projects in more detail. They gathered additional input. There were some of those plans that they went out and measured, and they thought they came back with some feedback and said maybe we need to kind of rearrange some spaces due to the flow, traffic flow, and I can think of, like, at Farmington Elementary, there were some risers involved, and so they thought maybe we should do things a little bit differently there in terms of safety for that. They also considered some built-in elements, and then they also considered that layout of the spaces, again, for the workflow parts. And so that's the overview that I just wanted to give you to kind of lead into our specifics. And today you'll hear from a group from Riverview Dodge, and another one from our high school. You heard about one space at the high school last time, and you'll be hearing about the other one tonight. And so with that, we're going to start off with Riverview Elementary and Lindsay Jensen and Jessica Vadnis, who are two teachers who are on the design team for this space. I don't know what works best for you, but here it is.
That's fine.
Okay.
All right,
there you go.
Thank you. Good evening. I'm Jessica Vadnis, fourth grade teacher at Riverview Elementary, teach math, science, and social studies.
And I'm Lindsay Jensen, and I also teach fourth grade math, science, and social studies.
This year we started co-teaching together, so we take two sections of fourth grade in the morning to work out in our shared gold pod area and do math instruction out there as a large group. We also do the same thing in the afternoon with three classrooms. So we take all students into the shared space and started co-teaching this year. And what we found through this design process is that we really needed a space that was going to accommodate larger groups, which allows us to co-teach and really pull small groups that are needed. So if she has some students maybe that are struggling in her class, I can join them with my class, or if she has some advanced students in her class and I have some in mine, she can take that small group, but we're still in that shared space together.
So in our design layout, we kind of have three different types of learning spaces. The middle area is that, as it says, extended learning area where students can work in alone or with a group. The two side spaces that are a little bit larger are instructional zones. So this might be where like a whole group lesson is taking place. So there's some risers there and then also some whiteboard tables. And then we have two smaller areas. One's the think tank and one is the reading room, which would be quieter spaces. In the reading room, and then the think tank would be a collaboration room for students.
And I guess if you can envision in the extended learning area, you know, a teacher may be out there working with a small group while several other students are working independently, while, you know, on either the right or left side, there could be a teacher doing instruction at the same time. So we're really kind of accommodating to students' and learners' needs. And then on the left-hand side, you could also have another teacher instructing over there as well. There is a glass partition wall that is able to be closed or open. So that invites, you know, if you need to accommodate for a larger space or if you want that closed off as another section to use.
On both sides of the pod area, there are two middle classrooms on each side that will have windows put in place to provide some visibility from inside of our classrooms that we currently have into this pod area, so you can extend the learning even beyond this pod area into our current classrooms.
And there currently is a library out there that is used for fourth and fifth grade students, and so we're looking at getting some movable shelving in there so we can structure it a little bit differently, make it easier for students to access those materials, but not be disruptive to instruction that's going on. And I guess a big part of this too is just having flexible seating for individual learner needs, where some kids like to stand, so we have adjustable height tables. Maybe some kids want a surface to write on, so there's an independent chair that has a desk space on it. There's different seating arrangements for smaller groups to collaborate. And so it's just really meeting their needs that way as well.
This is just another model of what it would look like in 3D.
Those two, so one would be the thick tink, again, a collaborative space for students to use, but again, keeping the visibility for teachers. With having the glass walls, and then that reading room as well would kind of have a different feel to it, but again, we can still see in there when students are using those spaces.
So the top picture shows those like glass barn doors, which just allows the teacher visibility into there, but allows it to be quiet in that space. I don't remember if I mentioned, the two instructional zones do have some technology equipment that is going to be placed there. Currently, we're out there teaching right now, and we have found it just really difficult to teach in that space. We currently have a screen, but don't have anything to necessarily write on or use easily to do instruction, so.
We have a projector screen, and then we have like two whiteboards next to it because we can't write on the projector screen. So having some technology in there would really help since all the students are one-to-one, and it would just allow us to facilitate our instruction a lot more efficiently.
Any questions? Are there any questions for the Riverview project? All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Members of the board, I'm Chris Busman, principal here at Dodge Middle School. Not here, I'm not, this is actually City Hall. Standard phrase. And with me tonight, we have Jen Crines and Lorraine Kennedy, and they're going to do the majority of the speaking. But what I want to set up is the context for what we're going to talk about tonight. And that is something that's tied to our strategic plan at Dodge Middle School, which we went through a second revision in 2017, last spring. The first one was 2012. And something that's really founded in really good middle school design. And that's through the Association of Middle Level Education. And so Dodge Middle School is a wonderful building, but if you've ever been to the E-Wing, which is to the east of the building, there are 30 classrooms in a very, very tight two-story footprint. And when that building was built, it was built with six houses in mind. And at the center of each house was a big team planning center for teachers that was used for 45 minutes a day. The rest of the time it sat idle, and then two small breakout rooms. And over the past couple of years, we've really been thinking about how can we use our space a little bit different, knowing that we work with adolescents. And not every adolescent is ready to be given wings and fly the moment that they hit sixth grade. And so part of our design tonight is gonna take a look at some of that readiness and think about the collaboration that we're really trying to instill with our students. And so I'm gonna turn it over to Lorraine and Jen.
Hi, I'm Jen Crines. I teach sixth grade language arts at Dodge.
I'm Lorraine Kennedy. I teach social studies and transitions, sixth grade.
And what you're looking at here is our design to really open up one of those spaces, those house spaces. Currently, like Chris was saying, there's one large room where students collaborate and then two little breakout rooms. And we thought it would be best to demolish all of those walls, really open up the space, and incorporate a variety of different flexible seating so that students can work individually to collaborate. And then we can also use it as a large group space. We envision this as a really comfortable space. Think bright colors, think living room, think creative. And some of our furniture choices, I think, will follow that.
I think even going to the floor plan is the flow. I think someone else had mentioned the flow of the room. We want to still be able to get kids from one section or one room to another. So the flow of it is conducive to that. Do you want to flip to the next? So following that, even form follows function. So we have a variety of different collaboration areas, and you can see the tables. Everything is movable except for the one pillar in the middle. That's obviously there to hold the building up. So we plan on putting a standing type of a counter around that. Kids like to stand, kids like to move around, so that'll be an area that will be functional all the time. But at the same time, all of the tables and chairs and whatnot can be moved so that we can have that space for 150 kids if we have a meeting area. Each area has its own lighting that will support the different learning areas. Along, when I'm looking at the left-hand side, that is a hallway that wraps back around, and that area has cafe type of seating, so it's conducive to 2 to 4 kids sitting at it at a time, independently working or collaboratively working. And then as you can see along the walls, maybe not on that one, yeah, I guess you can see there's a countertop with some stools at it, but also it could be another area to stand at.
There's some technology. There are some charging stations. near that pole. We have TVs mounted on three of the walls. We envision that being used for instruction, for students to present, for house meetings where you've got 150 kids gathered in that space. There are some whiteboards there. I think that's it for technology.
And talking about the distance from the tower being the home base of the teacher that actually has students working out there, we kind of there are students that are not quite ready for that piece, but for the students that are, we need that piece for their independent learning. I think it would be really fun.
Here's one more view.
And the form that follows function, we defined the cave. We have an area in that area that is actually under the staircases, the stairwells, and we kind of call that the cave, so as we refer it to as the cave. It's a quieter area. It's going to have three walls with an outside exit, so it has windows to the outside, so it has that natural lighting for those quiet spaces if kids do need to get away for a moment and get to that area to work quietly independently.
And then there's one more addition of a hydration station for students. And next, we're ready to pick out furniture for this. So I guess I think kind of Google meets Starbucks with this kind of an area. Thank you.
One of the things I forgot to mention is that one of the critical components of middle school is a lot of team celebrations. And when I was at Middle School East, which is now Riverview, they've got those large open spaces that we used to have, those big house meetings. And then Bachman has massive amounts of space for people to do team meetings, whereas right now we have to kind of get the key and crank open a wall between two classrooms. We try to get to the cafeteria, or we'll fill up two staircases in a common space to try to do these house meetings. So all of this furniture is meant to be quickly moved off to the side and be able to have 150 students in for that celebration. So any questions for us?
Can you explain that tower concept again? I'm trying to understand what you mean by the tower. Is that just the teacher where they're observing, or is there a, like?
Well, we kind of, Chris, do you want to jump into this? Too?
So when you think about Farmington High School has a much more open concept than we do because their students are more ready for it. And so we've been, for the last 5 years, we've got furniture kind of throughout the building in the main hallway, in a lot of different places where when students say, you know what, I kind of have what I need to do, I'm going to go off to a space that works for me. We have many students that do that very, very well. We also have many students that don't do that very well. And so what we like to do is we call the tower, the flight tower. When we're ready to let that plane take off, we're going to let them take off to a distance that we're comfortable with in terms of supervision. And once they demonstrate that readiness, then kind of that freedom naturally is going to follow. So
if I can clarify, so what you're meaning is that from any point, a teacher has a vantage point of all the students, depending on what level they're functioning at? Is that? Okay. So there's not a physical tower, it's just being able to have line of sight to see the different zones.
No, there will be no supervision tower, just
okay.
More.
Just check.
The theory behind it, yep.
I'm trying to envision this and I can't for the life of me, and I'm thinking of what the layout of the school and the three houses. Where is this at? Can you help me better understand?
Point.
Like, I'm envisioning the staircase and walking in, like, say, on the left, and there's a house there. Is this replacing
that house? Yep, so this is what's referred to as the Puma House, which is the first floor in the back. And then up at the very top is where the main hallway would come to that back area, where the arrow is pointing up to the top of the TV is kind of a fire exit. And then those are the two stairwells that go up to the second floor.
Okay.
Where the extended learning area is currently where we have a team office and then two small breakout rooms behind it.
Okay.
And so those walls would be removed.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. Jason Merck, principal of Farmington High School, and Scott Meyer, one of our PE teachers, and he's going to do most of the heavy lifting when it comes to talking about this space. It's been a good day. Because of the size of the building, some of the opportunities, we were lucky enough to have two different spaces. And one of the spaces we went after when we talked to you the first time was, again, to give kids more opportunities to have some spaces to do collaborative work and to have more areas for them to go when they have time. To use some of their time and their work flexibly. This is a little bit different space. We are very fortunate to have Scott on our staff. I'm not sure if you know or not, but he is not only one of the top PE instructors and fitness people in the state of Minnesota, but he's also president of one of the boards. Which board is it? High school strength and conditioning. So, you know, one of the things with our strategic plan is really giving people the opportunity to take their passions and move that. And so this space is going to allow Scott to do that and continue to really help our students to have some of these unique opportunities. But it also fits a need for us as well. A little bit like Chris talked about when they talked about the design of their building. When our building was built in 2009, it was built under one premise. And when you look at Phi Ed, it was kind of the old school weight room, and then you had a little bit of a cardio room, and then you had your gyms, and that was it. And over the past 10 years or 8 years, whatever it is, we know that physical fitness has changed dramatically. And so we are looking at a space that's going to allow us to be much more flexible and much more unique to meet the needs of our students. I'm going to let Scott kind of talk a little bit more about that.
Okay, so we're talking about the textbook storage room, which is right across the hall from the girls' locker room. So it's right around the corner where the weight room is. And this really is a completely unique, one-of-a-kind kind of setup in a room. There's really nothing like this in the country. So we're pretty excited about what we can do with this. So it's going to allow us to enhance all kinds of opportunities and enhance what we're doing within our classes, as well as creating some new space. Looking at next trimester, I know second hour, I just happened to look today, I've got a class of 51 kids or 51 students in my sports conditioning class. We're going to be sharing the weight room 2 days a week with Mr. Wyatt's weight training class, which also has 50 students in it. So we're going to have, if everyone's happens to be there on the same day, we've got, you know, 100 plus kids in the weight room at one time. So this allows us to take kids out and do something different. And if you notice around the room, there are no benches. Okay, so it's somewhat of a resistance training room. We can do some traditional weight stuff. But we also have the overhead bridges connecting or making use of the center pillar in that room. So we can do all kinds of overhead or utilize that overhead space by incorporating some TRX systems, which is a suspension system where you're using your body weight against resistance, involves the core a lot. But pretty much everything that's not overhead is going to be ground-based movements. So students are standing on their feet while we're moving. But then it's also extremely open in the middle because we're using the stuff overhead. It doesn't eat up floor space. So there's also the room to do like whole group fitness classes. There's enough overhead space to do a TRX class or workout with everyone all at one time. There's room to do a kettlebell workout. There's room for sandbag class. So there's all kinds of things, not only individually, but also as a group kind of setting, which we don't have. And then this would be the view kind of looking from the doorway into the room right now. So it's extremely functional. I tried to get some ideas from other coaches around the country about what we could do with this or what else we can add, kind of threw some ideas at them. And to be honest, I didn't really get any help from anybody because no one knows what this is. There isn't one like this anywhere. There's not a room like this. So everyone kept kind of tying back into a weight room situation. And we're like, well, it's kind of a weight room, but it's not a weight room, something else. So we're talking innovation. This is one of those super innovative spaces we're really excited about.
How many students can you fit in there at once?
To work right now it's planned comfortably 44 easily, and that would be like working with partners, but we certainly could add more and add stations, so 44 will be no problem at all.
I think you already said this, but where would this be?
This is the textbook storage room right across from the girls' locker room before the training room. Yep.
Oh, will that room stay intact? There won't be any walls that come down, so it'll be two separate weight room areas.
Yeah, completely separate. Yep, it's down the hall, so it's possible, you know, we could share equipment or do some things back and forth. We have been doing more yoga this trimester with our weight training classes on our non-lifting day, so this space would be a perfect yoga space because next trimester we've got aerobics classes up in the studio all day, so we don't have that space. So.
And obviously this is, I mean, to Scott's point, it's super innovative trying to get work, but for us as a building, we need another FIAD station, just to be quite honest with you. When we start to build the master schedule and the time that goes into it, I ended up spending a lot of time with Scott and Mr. Wyatt and Ms. Ami to kind of figure out which classes can we have together so they can share space and moving things around. So, you know, it's the nice thing about the growth of our student body. It's also a nice thing with our schedule that kids have so many opportunities to pick so many different electives. And PE is a big elective for our students, whether it's the weight training classes, it's the fitness classes, aerobics classes, and things like that. We have a lot of different choices, and our kids take advantage of them, which is a good thing.
Any other questions?
Mr. Chair.
Yeah.
This kind of looks like a ninja warrior training room. I'm looking for the salmon ladder. It looks like it's almost there.
We tried to put water in, but they said no.
Yeah, not quite that extreme, but when it comes to audition time, our kids are going to probably have an advantage.
Scott, how did you come up with this concept?
It's kind of started out with like a CrossFit box kind of formation where, you know, they've got these rigs around the outside of the room. And then there are some college teams that have like rows of racks with bridges going across like this, so you can do all kinds of overhead stuff. So it's kind of like a blending of the two. And the pillar in the middle kind of threw a wrench in things a little bit, but I've been working with Sornex Equipment and sent it to their designers, and they came up with this, and like this is pretty cool.
Mr. Chair,
yeah.
Just for the practicality, you were saying this could be used as like a group fitness space too.
Mm-hmm.
I'm seeing all those, I don't know, what's hanging down to that all come up, so then you just have those bridges on the top, but everyone could still do something together. Is that kind of how you're seeing it?
Yes, the yellow handles with the black straps, those are just like nylon webbing. So those, when we're not using them, those would come off and we'd store them. So there are a couple posts in the middle, but otherwise it's the center is pretty wide.
And it'll have a projector so you can project on a wall, mm-hmm. for group stuff, and a couple of different TVs. That's the plan right now. I have a couple TV screens so kids can have instant access to things like that you don't quite see. So again, yeah, that was one of the things of the design part that they talked about, was being able to have whole group instruction in there, not just be for individuals. And so that whole group can look lots of different ways, but to have a class in there.
Yep, there's just a lot of more space and a lot different type of thing that we cannot do in the current weight room, just because of space limitations and stuff's packed in pretty close.
What's the plan for everything that's in the room currently?
Great question. It's like anything, we don't let those kind of get in our way. So we'll have to do some work. There's some stuff in there that's stored, but to be honest with you, we have a lot of books from a long time ago. We have dictionaries and thesauruses and things like that. We have old math books and things. There's a few departments that still use that, but we do have some other storage area in the building. So we'll start to, once everything is finally finalized, we'll start to have some of those plans and stuff. And Mr. Miller is so graciously working with us. We have a lot of old desks that we brought over from the high school that we're still storing, and he's working to move those. And so we've gotten rid of about 100 of those. And so again, as we kind of declutter some of the things that we've been hanging on to, we'll free up some other space, but we'll find areas. This is, I think, again, when the building was designed, the idea was that every textbook went down there. It has a little half door that you open up and you get your book and things like that. And the reality is that, you know, with what we're doing now instructionally, we do have textbooks in some classes or books, but just not as many of them. And so we can find other places for those really to be stored instead of just, and to be, when you walk in there, it is just, there's just stuff all over. I mean, they have the nice sliding things and things, but there's just stuff that, you know, when people don't really put stuff in there, things just appear. So we'll have to make some of that disappear.
Mr. Chair, one quick question. We have our student board members. I'd love to hear you guys' feedback on what the space looks like.
I think this is a really cool idea. I took a class last year with Mr. Meyer, actually, and there was a weight training class in the same time that we would be in there. And just like having a different space, more area, is, I think that's going to be really, really nice. And I can see this concept, and I like hear about like CrossFit and stuff, and this seems like a really cool idea.
I don't really exercise that much.
I didn't put you in the spot, too.
I do have...
You would in this room.
Yeah.
Yeah, in that room, definitely. No, I have a lot of friends who like to do the exercising that I don't like to do. And I think that this is like a really awesome idea, and I think it can incorporate a lot of cool ideas, and I'm really excited to see how it works out.
All right, any other questions or admissions of non-exercise that we'd like to make?
I would just like to say, for those of us that have kids that like to be in the weight room, thanks a lot, because this is going to extend that. I'd love to be there in the middle of the night so they can get it all in.
All right, thank you.
And just to wrap it up, I have just what's here on the screen. So at our next board meeting, the final designs of all 9 learning spaces will be brought to you. For your approval to begin the bid process. And again, that presentation will be with Dan Miller, Jane Huska, and Wold Architects. Anyone else for that? Okay, so that they'll be here with those for you. And then timeline-wise, we're looking at coming back then for you to look at awarding the bids in February, February 12th. That's the tentative timeline at this point.
All right. Any questions about the timeline?
Just one. So we do the final bid. It's going to be everything, because I think you mentioned like TVs and stuff like that. It's going to be the whole kit and caboodle on that, correct?
There'll be. I see Jane is making faces at me, so I'm going to ask her to come up here and talk to that a little bit. I know there are some things that are in there and some things that aren't, but the face tells me she knows specifics.
Thanks. So some of the projects are actually going to be less than $100,000. So when we come final bids, those will not probably be coming back in front of the board, because per what was the guidance from the board, anything less than $100,000 we're okay to move forward with. Anything above that, we would come back for. So anything above $100,000 we'll be coming back and discussing with you. And we are working on them to be all inclusive for technology, furniture, the whole 9 yards.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? All right. Hearing none, we will move on to the next item, which is graduation survey results with Ms. Barb Dufferin.
Okay, so I am returning to you to give you the results of the graduation survey, which we talked about back in September. We put together a survey to get some feedback on a few items. You asked for some opinions regarding the number of tickets. You wanted to know the number of tickets people needed, because depending on that, you might want to think about moving graduation to another location. You wanted to know about what people's opinions were about the location of graduation, and also about the cost of the ceremony as well. So we did put this together, and we sent it to all families in the district. We had it open for 2 weeks, and we had 1,165 responses. So attached to the board packet, you do have the questions and the responses, and that the whole survey itself is there. And the reason I attached that is because in this presentation, some of my questions have to get cut off in order to be put on a slide. But you can look at the entire question there in the packet. So the first question had to do with the number of tickets people would need. Now, of course, if the weather is nice and we're able to be outside, then there is no worry about the number of tickets that each family can have. But if the weather is, you know, if we can't be outside and we need to be inside, we would have a limit to the number of tickets. So for this year, we are planning to have graduation at Farmington High School. We'll be outside. If the weather is not good, we would have to go to, I think it was 6 tickets. Now I look at Mr. Burke, 6 tickets this year? Yes. However, the following year, if it's in the same case, if we're at the high school and if we needed to be outside, I think the best we could do would be 4 tickets per family because of the size of the class. And I look to Mr. Berg again, and I get confirmation. Okay, so that's the situation. So this year we are planning to be at Farmington High School, and to be outside, weather permitting. So I give you all of that, and then the question was about how many would you need? And the reason we stopped at 5 or 6 is because that's what we have as a maximum right now, and we know it won't be more than 5 or 6 in the future. So at any rate, as you can see, the majority of families are needing 5 or 6 tickets at least. Our second question had to do with some districts renting a larger indoor space off campus in order to provide ample seating regardless of weather. And knowing this, we know that they are going to have limited control. We hear from other districts that use this option, they have limited control over the date and time of graduation. So if knowing this, what would be their priority? Would they prioritize having the graduation stay at Farmington High School, or having, if you had to choose between the two, having as many tickets as a family needs? And you see there's a slight preference for to be at Farmington High School. So then what I tried to do is I tried to combine those two questions and look and see, I pulled out the ones that needed 3 or 4 or 5 or 6, because that those are the ones that needed the most tickets. And so if we look at the priority of those families that need the most tickets, would they prioritize graduation at Farmington High School, or would they make their priority as many tickets as the family needs? And so the way to read what I have here is I took the total number of respondents. So I've got, 41% of all the people that answered this question, or it took the survey, would need 5 or 6 tickets and would prioritize as many tickets as a family needs. But there are also 29% of all the people that answered would need 5 or 6 tickets, but would still prioritize graduation at Farmington High School. Does that make sense how I did that? So what I'm trying to do here, just so you understand, is I'm trying to anticipate what your follow-up question would be with when I put these together, okay? So there are other ways we can do this, but I tried to guess at what are the things that you would probably want to know in order to get the feedback the best feedback you could on this. So the third question had to do with the ceremony cost, there was an explanation of what the $45 went to for the ceremony. Also referenced the board meeting where we discussed it, so if families wanted more information on it, they could look that up as well. At any rate, you'll see that knowing this, knowing what the graduation ceremony fee is for, families said they were comfortable, majority of families said they were comfortable with the $45. Then the question was, I knew that you were not interested in raising the fee, so I didn't even ask the question, would you be okay with raising the fee, because I knew that wasn't part of the conversation. But if it's the case that we need to move to another location, we know that there would be more costs associated with it. So question 4 came out of that. So some districts, again, rent a larger space off campus to provide ample seating regardless of weather. So knowing this, if we did move off campus, would you be comfortable contributing more than the current fee, or are you not comfortable? And you can see that there's a slight, there are slightly more people that said, even, you know, if we moved off campus, I would not be comfortable contributing more than the current fee. So then I did this again, and I said, okay, if we have the priority as many tickets, the families who said our priority is as many tickets as the family needs versus the priority at graduation at Farmington High School, and then comparing that to who's comfortable with an increase in fee, if I look at the priority of as many tickets as a family needs, we've got 29% of the respondents said, I want to make sure we have as many tickets as we need, and I'd be comfortable spending more. Does that make sense? So it's 29%.
Of the total respondents. Okay.
So what I wanted to do is not disregard the people that were in the minority by saying they wanted 1 or 2. So I didn't take them out of the total number of people we're talking about, but I am focused in on the larger groups here in this.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense?
Yep.
Okay. I also did the same thing about increasing fees when I compared it to who needed three or four tickets and five or six tickets. And you can see those folks that would need five or six tickets. So we're looking at 37% of all the people that answered said, I need five or six tickets, and I'm comfortable contributing more than the current fee. But 33% of everybody who answered said, I need five or six tickets, but I'm not comfortable contributing more. How are we doing? Is this making sense?
Yeah.
Are you still with me? Mm-hmm. Okay, so with all this, I mean, what you can, I think, so I'm going to just try and summarize what this says to me. Families of current students are comfortable with the current graduation ceremony fee, the way it is. I think we also see that the community does value graduation at the high school, having graduation at the high school and not having it someplace else. And technology will allow us to mitigate some, but not all the needs of our community. So you have a very close, I mean, you can see that the only place that you really saw a really, you know, you saw that 80% of the families were okay with the graduation, the fee, the ceremony fee as it is. But then once you got to, should we go on or off campus, you got really close. Mm-hmm. And so you're going to see that, I think to me what this says is that whatever we do, if it's not sunny and it's not at the stadium, we're gonna have people who are upset with us. So as long as it's sunny and we can be at the stadium, we're in good shape. But if there's rain or we go someplace else, there will be some stress. So, questions on any of this?
Are there any questions?
Mr. Chair?
Yep.
So we've talked about the investment in the technology for kind of that live stream option. And I'm curious as far as, you know, you talk about technology will allow us to mitigate. It's, of course, it's not like sitting in the same room, but some of those live stream technologies actually could be a better viewing for some people based on where they're sitting or whether they're ambulatory or not, or, you know, all sorts of things that it, maybe they come in from out of town and you park them in front of the big screen at home and they can see, you know, super close that way. I don't know, but I guess my curiosity is, you know, have we validated kind of what that technology could do in supporting an event like this?
Have we validated? I think...
Or investigated, not validated.
Oh,
we
okay.
Haven't even... Have we investigated validations like...
Well, I think it's safe to say that the streaming is exactly as you describe it. It would give something that's a little bit more up close. But beyond that kind of investigation, I guess I would say no. You know, it's streaming technology, so
mm-hmm.
It would give it exactly as you describe it. Mm-hmm.
Mr. Chair,
yep.
To add to that conversation, was technology asked about on the survey about having this option? I don't think I saw it in the questions.
I believe I'd have to go back, and I don't have it in front of me, but I think I did put in there that we would have technology. So they're going to look into that for you. Right now I see heads down and people looking at the survey.
I was looking at your summary report and I don't see it, but that doesn't mean I'm not.
Are you looking at the actual survey?
The question one does say, given the district's ability to stream the graduation, how many tickets would...
Oh,
so it is addressed.
It's inherent in the question.
Yep.
Okay. I'm sorry. Mr. Chair.
Yep.
I appreciate you doing the survey and getting the information out there. I think it kind of ties back to having the communication out there in the forefront of what the ceremony fee was for. Taylor had mentioned that at the board meeting, that people just didn't understand what it was for, and I think this might have actually helped get the communication out there a little bit more, because
mm-hmm.
It's interesting seeing the results, so thank you.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions?
When will we know more about the streaming? Because I want to make sure if we're going to go down that path, which we are, that we have that good quality streaming, because as you see right now, streaming is in and out a lot of the times. Mm. I would hate that, you know, all of a sudden we're in a packed house and all of a sudden, you know, based on technology or whatever, we have interference and all of a sudden we can't stream it good.
Mm-hmm. So are you looking for an ability to see it for yourself, or what exactly?
No, I guess I'm making, I just want to make sure we double check it, because like we'll stream high school football games and stuff, and people can't see it. Mm-hmm. So I just want to make sure that the quality is there, and if there's any roadblocks from a technology standpoint, mm-hmm. that we make sure we address and overcome it.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Chair? Yeah. Thanks for the question. Did anyone see the streaming? The streaming for the Patriotic Day. We did stream Patriotic Day. And I haven't heard actually report back, but we do have the ability to stream, and it's supposed to be good. It's supposed to be good. They were so proud to show me the new box and everything back that we do have and the ability to do that. So I don't see anyone who streamed it, but we'll check on that, see how well, see what the users thought.
Did we tape it by chance, the streaming of that? Did we tape it? Do you know?
Yes. Mr. Chair? Yes. Yeah, so with the band concert that's going on like right now as we speak, we tested out the live stream stuff that we were doing, that we're hoping to do tonight, so that the students could watch the concert as well as fill the entire recital hall with people. And I TA during fourth hour, so I was helping kind of test out and sit in the band room today while there were people playing in the recital hall, and it really did work well. So I don't know if that's a huge conflict.
Thanks.
So it's already up and running.
I know.
Obviously.
I know.
I was wondering if it was even.
What we use for Patriotic Day is what we are using? I see, yes.
Right.
So when we're live streaming, are we putting like the links on the website, or how are people accessing that then?
How about I assure you that by graduation, that will be very clear to all people.
Sounds good.
About before the winter band concerts.
Yeah, I think that would be,
really helpful.
That's right.
Add that as an agenda item in an upcoming meeting about, you know, maybe a little bit. We're kind of getting way off topic at this point. But
just an update on the
Streaming and maybe examples of how to access it, how we know if it's going to be used for an event, what events they're targeting, something like that.
Yeah, we can add that.
Because the picture was, to your point, for Patriotic Day, the picture was beautiful in the cafeteria. I mean, it was crystal clear, and
okay. The
volume was fantastic. I just want to make sure that it, you know,
it
stays that. Yeah, I mean, it was crystal clear.
Yeah, I think once we had the volume turned on.
once it was figured out, yeah.
That's right.
All right, are there any other questions on the survey?
I just want to say thank you, Barb, for doing the work related to that. I think that the survey gave us kind of a comfortable feeling of where we should go, and I appreciate you doing that work.
Thank you, Barb.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right. We will move on to the next discussion topic, which is the food service facility discussion with Ms. Jane Huska and Mr. Dan Miller.
Good evening, Chair Cordes, members of the board, Superintendent Haugen, members of the audience. Just wanted to take a couple minutes here this evening to make you aware that we are looking into doing some upgrades and some renovation at Aiken Road in the kitchen. The equipment there is original to the building. Yep. and so we do have some needs there. And so we are working with Wald Architects and then Ripa Associates, who is basically a kitchen, industrial kitchen designer. It's not necessarily Wald's forte with that. We met, I think it was November 1st, that we met on site and kind of began taking a look at what we have, what we need. So Peggy Anderberg was definitely part of that discussion. And primarily we're doing it now because we know that we need to do it, and we also want to try to get out in front of this. As you may have heard, we had many of the school districts in our surrounding areas that were out for bonds, and fortunately many of them were successful, which is great. That also means that there will be some pretty stiff competition to get work done in the upcoming months. And so we're trying to get out front of that. So they will be bringing us some designs. Peggy's provided them with kind of the equipment needs that are there. The one piece that I do want to make you aware of is that as soon as we start altering equipment, In those spaces, there's a good chance that some of the equipment, specifically our hood that's in that space, will no longer meet current code requirements. So that's a big variable that we don't know yet. And so that's kind of the first piece that they're working on in terms of just a design piece, checking in with some of that to know what we might be facing down the road. So we're very, very preliminary with the process, but that's kind of where we are. And also from a funding mechanism, just so that you're aware, that would be coming out of the food service fund balance, and with the audit pieces that are wrapping up here, we hope to know what that dollar value that we would have to spend by the end of this month. So all those things will come into play, but just basically wanted to give you an update that we're kind of taking a look at it, and we'll continue to update you. One other thing that I did want to also mention, I should stop and just, any questions with any of that?
Okay. Any questions?
Is the Aiken Road cafeteria equipment the oldest in the district at this point, or?
Yes, I believe, yes, yeah.
All right.
One other just quick note, we've talked a little bit in the past about the ISC tuck pointing project, and bids are slated to open for that tomorrow afternoon, so we'll be coming back with that information here shortly as well. So.
All right.
That's all I have.
Thank you, Dan.
Thank you.
Next up, we have the boundary scope update with Ms. Jane Huska.
Mr. Chair, board members, Superintendent Haugen, members of the community, thanks for having me here tonight. I am here to continue the conversation that we started back in October on the 9th regarding future consideration for boundary changes and school start time. Since then, we met as a committee, roughly about 9 of us, to discuss the questions, some of the questions that you posed at that October 9th meeting, which comprised of capacity of our buildings, do we do it now, do we do it later, what about a capacity study for our buildings, are we using our buildings differently at the different levels, elementary versus middle school versus high school, and how does that affect our capacity? What about the 2040 comp plan for Farmington? What land is going to be developed? What about Lakeville? What developments do they have? And bus routing, what do we do with that? How is that going to take into consideration for boundaries? What can we do? What can't we do? What cost will we might incur? So we thought we would start giving foundation information to the board, talk about what we believe as preliminary for the committee, what our scope is going to be, and our preliminary process that we developed. So we'll first talk about the development within the city of Lakeville, but are in our school district. Then we'll move on to Farmington, talk about our capacities and school start times. So we are fortunate enough during our meeting to have Daryl from the city of Lakeville to come over and provide insight into the development taking place within Lakeville, within our school district boundaries. And one development that is currently ongoing is Pleasant Run. Now, phase one and phase two are the plots that plat that you're currently seeing on here, and it consists of 94 single homes. They have a phase three that they are currently talking with the developer on, and it is going to consist of 99 single homes, and the home value is ranging between $300,000 and $400,000, and they're looking at building this whole development out in the next 3 to 5 years. And one thing that I should mention, everything that we're talking about tonight is also just hinged on economy, housing development, interest rates. And so everything that I talk about could totally go out the window if just one single variable changes. And so as a committee, we realize that we know that we're gonna have to change and evolve as things move along in this process. So just keep in mind as we talk about this. Pheasant Run is currently slated to attend North Trail Elementary and Dodge Middle School. The next development, which is just east of Pheasant Run, is Pleasant Run. They are owned by the same developer. They currently had their first meeting last week with them. This development is a little different, looking at 158 single homes with 58 townhomes, and looking to be developed out in the next 5 to 7 years. One of the nice things about this, it's going to extend 179th all the way to Pilot Knob. So it'll be a nice through street that will be connected when the development gets done. And then if we want to talk about kicking tires, right, there we talked about some development just north of Pleasant Run. The owners of that land, which would be on the east side of Pilot Knob, north of 180th, north of Pheasant Run, have had a couple of conversations with the city, but nothing real, pressing. But he just mentioned it saying, it could, come sooner rather than later. You just don't know when all of a sudden someone decides, oh, I'm going to develop this. And so that would be the next area for us to be concerned about or looking at.
Mr. Chair, which area were you saying?
It would be north. Here, let's see if I can go back. So see the top of this is all Pheasant Run, but just to the north of that is additional land that could be developed.
Okay.
And that was the owner that's talked a couple of times, but nothing too serious yet. Back to Pleasant Run, this is actually slated to go to Aiken Road and Dodge Middle School. As we move on to Farmington, the first development we're going to take a look at is Fair Hill Estates, which is west of Highway 3, south of 195th. They are currently plotting that to have 220 homes. It'll be a mix of single-family homes and empty nester-style homes. The value of the homes will be between low to mid-300s, and they're looking at starting that development the fall of 2018. And this development is currently slotted for Riverview and Bachman. Our next development for Farmington is the Regatta Fields, and that is just south of the high school. That will have 61 single homes. They're looking at phasing it in two different phases. First one 30, the next one 31, or vice versa, it's one house. But they're looking at a house value of the low to mid 300s and starting the fall of 2018. This development is slotted for Bachman and Meadowview Elementary.
Pheasant Run was North Trail and Dodge, is that correct?
Pheasant Run,
yeah.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Sorry, they're so close. I'm like, really? Could you pick another name? The other thing that is very interesting when listening to the city talk about their 2040 comp plan is the current 655 acres along Flagstaff that will be coming out of the Ag Preserve. Just to give you a little insight, the Ag Preserve was a government program that was set up to help farmers protect their land from development. And so if farmers went into this program, they received tax credit in doing so, but also on the flip side, to get out of the program, it takes 8 years. So 8 years ago, I'd have to say, I want to get my land out of the Ag Preserve program. 8 years later, it actually comes out. So by the year 2020, on the road of Flagstaff, we're going to have 655 acres come out of the Ag Preserve. Now, does that mean that they're going to be ready to be developed and sell the land and all that good stuff? Who knows? But what it is one step closer that they are saying that we can do whatever we want with the land, with talking to the city to change the zoning and stuff like that. It just gives them one step closer to not only being farmland. It's just something we probably want to stick in our back pocket and to keep there.
Mr. Chair, mm-hmm. Just to clarify, so the land will go out of the agricultural preserve coding, the zoning.
Yep.
But that doesn't mean that those owners wish to sell the land. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Just took it off of the preservation list.
Right.
Okay.
So if they wanted to and they could get the zoning changed with the city, they could change it.
They could sell it. They could develop it.
So that would be variable, too, if the owners decide to sell the land and depending on what the city decides to zone the land as for in the future.
Correct.
So it could be commercial or it could be residential.
Absolutely.
Or...
Yep, and that was part of the conversation with the city. They actually discussed, the development of that land along Flagstaff will actually happen from the south going north because a lot of the development will have to be, you have to have sewer connection. And the connections for those areas are all in the south, all in the southern area of those land, of the land. And so in order, you can't like jump all the way north because a developer all the way north isn't going to pay for the whole sewer line to come from the south to get theirs. So it will start from the south and move north.
Thank you. That was interesting.
And after we got done talking about all the different developments, we went on to building capacities. And the last time we looked at our building capacities was in 2012. Now, we did do minor tweaks in 2015-14 when we started to go, before we went out for the referendum for the additions to the kindergarten classrooms. But the last time we did a study of all the district-wide was in 2012. And so then we had good conversations about, 2012 may not seem that long ago, but for us as a district, we have really changed the way that we use our spaces. And tonight was just a prime example how we are looking at our spaces differently. And so as a committee, we thought it was very important that we get a new study done. And we have talked to Wold Architects, and they are willing to do the study at no cost for us because we're already doing work with them. And so they'll be connecting with the schools to figure out capacities. They'll bring back how we're currently using the space, maybe make some recommendations, and we'll be able to process that information to make some educated decisions about our building capacities and how they may be used going forward. Then we started to look at school start times. The last time we looked at school start time was in 2009 before we opened up the high school. And as you know, for a community, it takes a lot to process all of that information because it really affects people's home life. If you have multiple children in different levels, how is the bus routing changing? What other internal issues or concerns do we have to be taking into consideration? So we had a great conversation around that topic as well. In the end, we as a committee would like to take two independent examinations of boundaries and school start times. Now, will there be crossover? Absolutely. But they're also, we thought, independent enough to keep them separate. And so we would like to do them as two examinations, and we'd like to take the next year to go through that process. And so the process that we'd like to follow, now this, again, remember, is preliminary and it can change along the way as things ebbs and flow, but we would start after the first of the year with community meetings, kind of do a state of the district. Where are we at? What are our needs? How are things going and how things might change or what our process may be? And then early winter, or late winter, early spring, we'll develop our groups and start getting our groundwork done for both of the committees. Late summer, early fall, we'll develop plans, we'll get community input, we'll bring it to the communities, and then by November, we'll bring recommendations to the board. And hopefully by December 2018, the board will be able to approve school start times if we recommend a change or if we want to leave them alone and any boundary changes that we might want to make. And then from there, we would communicate out to the community and implement any changes for the 19-20 school year. Does anyone have any questions?
Are there any questions for Jane?
I have a question.
Yep.
So the start times are kind of up in the air. That may or may not happen, but we're for sure, we know that we have to redraw the boundaries.
More than likely,
okay.
Yes. And does that mean just certain parcels, like we did last time? Or does that mean the whole district? That's yet to be seen.
Okay.
Mr. Chair, just to clarify, I haven't been on the board when we've gone through this process. Sometimes the bell times do get discussed just because the way the bus structures work. So that's just something that Evely happens as part of it. And if we're going to take the time, it makes sense to look at that as a whole as well.
Thank you for putting the timeline together, though. I like that.
All right.
All right. Thanks.
Thank you. Next up, we have the American Education Week, November 13th through the 17th, with Superintendent Hogan.
Well, thanks once again, Board Chair, members of the board, and our audience tonight. It seems the passing of the years each time the American Education Week comes around, and I usually use that opportunity, and I do it lightly tonight, to remind everyone that it is our system of education that really has been a big part of us being the people we are, people who are entrepreneurial, people who are leaders, people who go out and take risks. And a big part of that, the things that's different about us than everyone else, really almost in the world, is that we've always had local control. We haven't had big statewide systems, nationwide systems. We've always had a lot of local control. And some of that over the years has been eroded, and we fight to get that back, to have you and this school district be in charge of the education of its students. And we think that'll be an important for us to keep fighting for. But also internally, you know, we're different than a lot of school districts because we've learned that lesson and then passed that on, that we provide our staff a lot of trust and a lot of autonomy. And I think one of the main reasons we see so much great work in our school districts and so much excitement in our districts, in our district and our schools, and so many people coming to visit and see kind of the future of education here, is not that we've planned something, it's that we've turned that over to our teachers and our staff and our buildings. And got me thinking a little more about that because we had a Reinventing America. They had a big, I see Mr. Berg has left because he was at it with me. There was a big event downtown, and the person who has studied all the best efforts around the country, especially where lots of them aggregate together with schools, make really wildly better outcomes, real outcomes for students, things that really matter. Almost every one of them was places where they turned that stuff over, autonomy and trust, over to the teaching staff and over to the schools. So felt really good about that. So then, taking all that in consideration, whereas public schools are the backbone of our democracy, providing young people with the tools they need to maintain our nation's precious values of freedom, civility, and equality, and whereas by equipping young Americans with both practical skills and broader intellectual abilities, schools give them hope for and access to a productive future. And whereas education employees, be they custodians or teachers, bus drivers or librarians, work tirelessly to serve our children and communities with care and professionalism. And whereas schools are community linchpins, bringing together adults and children, educators and volunteers, business leaders, and elected officials in common enterprise. Now, therefore, I, Jay Haugen, serving as superintendent of the Farmington Area Public Schools, do hereby proclaim November 13th through the 17th, 2017, as the observance of the American Education Week. Signed this 13th day of November, 2017. Thank you.
Any questions? All right, we will move on to the last item under discussion topics, and that is board communication. I had a few requests over the last couple of weeks to put this on the agenda to talk about ways that we can improve our communications amongst ourselves and with the administration. So I'm going to open it up tonight to have any of those improvement type of processes or ways we can improve or reinforce current protocols. But also just wanted to throw out there the idea of possibly having a retreat that's facilitated by an outside person. MSBA is one idea. Just so we can have a longer, more in-depth conversation about these things, rather than just having it as an agenda item on our discussion topic tonight. So again, I'm gonna open it to you guys to talk about communication and ways we can improve, and any thoughts towards that retreat?
Mr. Chair?
Yep.
I would be in support. I think we had talked earlier this year, we had one brief retreat early on, and I feel like we had talked about next steps. I don't think this board ever fully went through protocols like previous boards had, and different dynamics and all of that kind of stuff, and people, we all make assumptions, and I think getting the group together to ground ourselves in what those assumptions are so that we're all on the same page of expectations. And I think, I mean, personally, I feel like there may not be even consensus amongst the six of us here. And I think having an initial conversation with the six of us before we go to the administration, I think that's a key part. But I think we have to understand what we're asking before we try to pair up with them and say, this is where we are standing, relatively unified. And then have that dialogue too, because I think having that dialogue between the administration is going to be also key, because they bring a different perspective. But I think if we are coming disjointed to that discussion as individuals, it makes it very difficult, I feel, for the administration to come forward and say, how do we accommodate this when we've got six different ways that we're being asked to do it? Whereas I think if the board were to come together and say, collectively, this is what we are going to make a request to the administration as far as what we feel would be good protocols and ways to handle communication, information requests, all of that kind of stuff, and then they can provide, and then we have that dialogue between the two groups.
Mr. Chair?
Yep.
Just kind of piggybacking on that, Julie, I did call MSBA because I wanted to know if that's even something we can do, is have a meeting just as a board, and they had indicated that we cannot unless the superintendent gives approval for that, for us to just have a meeting. Obviously, it wouldn't be a closed meeting, but I too had actually talked to Jake about how having time for us to talk is crucial in this process. I have received communication that administration doesn't feel like there's a communication problem that way, or with communication coming to us, and so I don't know where else to start unless we all together, the six of us, can have an understanding of what individually we are all feeling. I know I've heard from probably three different people other than myself that there's a feeling of a communication issue. And so I think we do need to identify what is that and what's the problem that we're not able to get past.
Can I just ask one clarifying question of both of you? If we were to bring in a facilitator, would you think it'd be of value to have that extra person in the room if we did just meet the six of us, just to keep us on task, or are you thinking just the six of us?
I guess when I was thinking of it, I was thinking just the six of us for that piece, just because I don't even think we know what we all agree on. Mm-hmm. One thing that I've struggled with in this process is not knowing before I started what the open meeting laws, how that impacts your ability to communicate and talk and discuss. And so I probably haven't been as effective as I can be because I don't really understand or feel like the process that's set up allows for good communication. So I guess I would see it as the six of us, but that's just my opinion.
Mr. Chair?
Yep.
I guess I would agree with Kristen in that respect because while having someone facilitate can be good, I feel like in this situation, if the whole point is for us to communicate and figure out a way for the six of us to work together, having someone else facilitate that is just someone else kind of impeding that process. That's just my thought.
Mm-hmm. I would concur with that. I think the six of us need to sit down and figure out the next direction to go in, and we also got to sit down and hold ourselves and everybody accountable because we do have these retreats and nothing comes of it.
Mm-hmm.
But I guess that, you know, I would agree. We have to, you know, be nice to put it on the calendar where the six of us could sit down and have a meeting on this. Yes.
Yeah, and I think having goals associated with this, that way we can measure how we've improved communication would be important mm-hmm. to have come out of this.
Mr. Chair, what I had requested also, talking about the last meeting, was having us do the MSBA self-evaluation tool.
Mm-hmm.
That might be a process of doing in. We could also invite them in to go over the results, and maybe that can be something that can be done kind of in the timeline, possibly. I mean, just kind of going from ideas, but possibly could start with that communication discussion just as a board, then maybe do that evaluation tomorrow and do the full process and bring maybe MSBA in to kind of evaluate that, because part of the process is setting up goals, measurable goals based on the evaluation that's of the board, which isn't just communication, but that would definitely be one area of it.
So we've had board evaluation tools for the past couple of years. I mean, I think we had members that weren't even on the board to offer evaluation, but we didn't even have all of our board members participate in previous ones, and it was an MSBA validated process. So how do you see this current one being any different than what we've been using historically? Because I agree, I think feedback is really important and we need to do that, but we haven't even had 100% participation of this group. So to Board Member Carrero's point, I think there's gotta be a level of accountability that all of us, if we are part of this board, whether we like it or not, if the decision of the board is we're going to do something, that all the members adhere to it. I think that's my personal struggle, is that I don't feel like meeting and discussing this unless we're all 100% in, that the group decision is what we all agree to. Because otherwise, all we're doing is the group decided I'm still going to do what I'm going to do. So that's my only holdout in this, is I'm all in for the discussion, but that discussion means that board evaluation, communication protocols, if we're going to go in, it can't be, well, when I like to or when it fits with my needs versus what we decide. And I think that's a crucial point. And if we aren't as a board going to agree to say whatever the group decides, we're going to adhere to it, all members, then this is an exercise in futility.
I would agree with that. I don't know that this board has had that opportunity for the six of us. I can't speak to what happened prior to last December.
Well, but we had a board evaluation that happened that never even, I mean, people participated in it, but not all board members, even sitting at this table, participated in like the self-evaluation of the board. And if we say that's important, that means all of us need to participate. And that's my point, is that we can get up here in front of the public and on the camera and say we're gonna do something, but unless we all 100% agree to it, this will just continue to happen. So all I'm saying is that I am 100% supportive of it, but that means my support is when six people are agreeing that we're going to, whether I end up in the majority or the minority, that when the decision's made by the board, as a member of the board, I adhere to that decision.
Well, I think it goes further than that. I mean, I think it starts with us and it goes on to the administration too. When we talk about accountability, I'm not gonna go to a meeting and waste my time because there's no follow-up after we have a meeting. And that goes for people sitting at this table, people sitting there, and for the public to understand that too. I'm not gonna spend two nights or 2 hours or 4 hours on a Saturday or an evening just to talk and get nothing done and no follow-up. And that's what we have been doing that needs to change. But it starts with just not the six of us, it's everybody in this room on that to move forward.
I agree with you, but I think as the board, it does start with us. They're very, very close, intertwined part of that. But when we're giving mixed messages as the board, individually or outside of meetings and that kind of stuff, and I agree. I think that how do we ensure accountability?
Yep.
But I think self-accountability is number one for those of us sitting at the table, and then we can hold others accountable. But I really struggle with us holding people accountable when I don't even get the sense at times that everybody at the table has that same sense of accountability.
No, and I don't disagree with that. But when we talk mixed messages and stuff, I agree 100%. But to know that if the message came across the wrong way, the other party's got to communicate that back. And you just can't be left standing there wondering, well, you know, do we have different opinion or what's going on? I mean, I think like what Jane did tonight, she had a timeline and everything that detailed, and you know, that's up to us now to hold everybody accountable, including ourselves to it. And I think every time we meet, that's what we need to do, is set the parameters on that.
I agree. Role definition, expectations. I mean, there's a whole
right.
Laundry list of things that I think, yeah, I agree.
But I think to move forward, I think we all we have some issues we got to overcome here. Mm-hmm. I'll be blunt. And we, to move forward, it starts, we got to sit down and talk here and get on the same page. And we are probably going to agree to disagree, but we haven't had the opportunity to sit down with all of us and talk about stuff. You know, and I think that's going to resolve a lot of it and to build those parameters to move forward on it.
Mm-hmm. So what I'm hearing is both using the evaluation tool, MSBA was suggested, and having a meeting of just the six of us to talk about not only communication expectations, but setting those parameters, other expectations, and ways to hold each other accountable would be the first two steps, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
And then working with the administration to build off of that. Is that fair to say?
I guess part of it is I guess we need to, I guess, I haven't talked to MSBA, so you got to correct me on if I'm wrong on this, but I guess to get this meeting going, we have to look at our superintendent on that, if that's something you're willing to do.
Well, that's quite a question, Member Carraro.
It is, and I don't mean to interrupt you on this, Superintendent Haugen, but time's a wasting here, and I want to make sure we move forward, yep. Because we're already, Thanksgiving's next week, and I look at a calendar, and we're, I want to get stuff resolved so we can move forward.
The question is about, you know, what actually MSBA kind of means by that. I can certainly choose not to come to a meeting, but I can't, like, order anybody else not to come to the meeting. It's not like I can close the meeting. I can tell you that I'm not going to come, but anyone else who wants to come, it's an open meeting, is able to come, and I can't stop
absolutely.
That.
Right. Right. Absolutely. Right.
So that's the way. Yeah, the one thing that if you wanted to go down this route, and we've explored this before, and a fairly new thing in this state, is that outgrowth of the BMS, the Board of Mediation, the Bureau of Mediation Services, there's the Bureau now of Conflict Resolution. It was built for this kind of thing. When you have a board or a council or some unit of government that is having difficulty coming together on something, that they can come in and close a meeting. They could sit down, but they would be there, but they could sit down with the six of you and try to work and iron things out. And that's one way that then they could decide what the meeting is, who's going to be there, and close the meeting. And we did have contacted them and talked to them before, and they do have the ability to do that. So that's another option on the table. I believe if you wanted to, we could explore that. Let me put it that way. If you wanted to have a meeting of the six of you, you know, I could agree not to come if you, that's the way that really works best for you. But that would still be an open meeting, and my guess is you would have people. Just because of that, you probably have more people than you would if we had just had a retreat sometime.
And the news, and the Star Tribune. Yeah.
So I would guess, but the other one is something we could look into.
So if you do the Board of Conflict Resolution, you can have a closed meeting? Is that what you're saying?
They actually have the okay from, I suppose, it's the Attorney General's office or something, to be able to close a meeting for conflict resolution. They have done that with other school districts. And while people have reported on that, they were not at the meeting. They were able to just say whether they agreed that should have happened or not, but they can close a meeting.
So but there would be someone present from that.
But yes, they would be there. They would be there, and that's what they're trained to do. These are people trained to do this, to get all of you together, and like has been said, to get you all on the same page and then come out of there with, this is who we are, this is how we're gonna move forward.
I think I agree. From what you guys have experienced from a facilitator, I mean, that the session that we held earlier this year, I felt like was driven more on education and information versus team building, that aspect of it, and not so much facilitating a problem, you know, a solution. Mm-hmm. And I don't know how many of you guys are familiar with lean processes and whatnot, but I mean, even developing what's called an A3, and it is a problem solving exercise essentially, and there's homework that happens ahead of time, and everybody who, I mean, I think that as people have been filing things to the chair, I mean, that's the sort of thing that a facilitator in a different measure could help us with something like this, whether it's MSBA or through the state, or even somebody that we were to pay to come in and say, we need you to help us facilitate, you know, getting to a resolution on something. And really what their focus could be is not team building or anything like that, but really just what is the problem? We all end up defining what that problem is, and then working together on what's the resolution to that problem. What are our expectations? And so it would be going through a facilitation at that point. The facilitator isn't part of the group, and that allows everybody, then nobody here at the table is trying to like keep everybody on track, or I mean, it's easy when we all bring different views to end up down a rabbit hole. And if we really have, you know, some homework that happens ahead of time, a facilitator that has, you know, they'll walk away from the day regardless of what it is, and it's ours to own from that point of view. I think there's value, and I agree. I think the state gives us a unique opportunity because then we could have, you know, probably a more comfortable open conversation if we have an opportunity to close a session, if it's facilitated through the state. And not to say that there isn't anything that we couldn't say in public, but I think people would be, I think people need to say what they need to say and let the group hear it in a safe way, respectfully and all of that kind of stuff. And my concern about an open meeting to some degree is that everybody walks away with a different perspective of that conversation. And the last thing I want to do, there's great things that are happening in Farmington, and there's good work by our administration and this board. So I don't want to say that it doesn't. But the last thing I want to see is us in the paper, you know, quoted for something that is a soundbite that's going to, you know, bring readers in versus, you know, the focus on what's the goal. The goal is that we want to be better. We want to do this better. And I think that's what the focus should be on. And that's my concern about, you know, outside of that is I don't want to glamorize the dirty laundry. I want to glamorize the fact that we are really trying to do something to be better.
Any other thoughts about the, I'm lost right now, the Bureau.
Conflict resolution.
Thank you.
I think it's something that we should look into, yes.
I mean, it wouldn't just be the six of us in the room, but it would just be somebody to guide us along. We'd still all be having that conversation. They would just be able to, A, close the meeting, but B, keep us on.
So then what happens to the next step? Because I know that I don't necessarily think everybody in this room agrees where the issue is, but I also don't think that it's just a board problem. And so when we get to that next step of, you know, dealing with that next part of how is this going to work, then I'm just curious as to maybe do we need to speak through when is best to have a facilitator? Is it best to have it when we six meet? Is it better to do that meeting, you know, with Jay and do it a closed meeting later? Or just trying to talk through some of those options, I guess, because I don't want anything to get lost in the, I will want my voice to be heard that I don't think it's just a board problem. I really don't. And I don't think I'm the only one up here that thinks that it's not just a board problem.
And I agree with you, Kristen. I think that if that's the end goal of, then what are the next steps? And it is, how do we then, what's the plan of action? I mean, if we were to do something like with the Bureau, then what is the plan of action? And that's maybe one of the goal statements at the very beginning to say, okay, once we decide, we're gonna develop an action plan, and the next step is, and that gets mapped out, and whether it is, you know, us just then meeting in another retreat with the administration on our own, or do we think that we need to have, I mean, we could decide that at that point in time. And, you know, my hope is that, yeah, maybe we're like, okay, this is what we're looking for. We go have that conversation, set a timeline. And maybe we start there, and then there's the division point to say, are we achieving what we are? Yes, if we're not, and what's the timeline? Just like what Jane described for the community and the boundaries and all of that. We can map something like that out and say, 3 months down the road or two, whatever that is, When do we measure that, yes, are we feeling like things are getting better, or no, or not? And then when we hit that point, then we do the next step. And I think we can stream map that out, essentially, to say, what are we looking to achieve? What's end goal state? And what are the steps that need to happen along the way? And where are the interventions if we're not at a certain point? Then what? And then we, as a group, are agreeing that that's what we expect. If we were to request the Bureau's assistance, how soon do you think we could get on their books? Do you have any? I know that they've waxed and waned as far as
yes.
availability and timelines and all of that kind of stuff, but.
Member Singwald, Chair Cordes, that's kind of been our experience with them when we have talked and heard from other school districts. Sometimes they have the availability and sometimes it'll take a while. But they also aren't necessarily one and done. It's not like they'll just meet with you and then walk away and let you figure it out. They'll work with you to put a whole system in place. Maybe that's the first meeting, and then maybe there's a second meeting where when they widen out who's there. They're here to get the whole thing resolved when they do come in. So all we could do is ask. We can just find out what their timelines are and who's available. So,
Mr. Chair,
yep.
What's the statute reference to be able to have a closed session just discuss things? Because it seems, I mean, I understand that there's a statute, but
yep.
I'm struggling with being comfortable with that.
Member Saucer, Chair Cordes, I don't, I certainly don't know what that is and what statute they do it under. And they did get, I'm sure it's through the Attorney General's office, and they got a letter that says they're able to do this. And so, you know, kind of the highest authority in our land, basically, that they're able to do this, and they have done this. And I haven't watched or talked to them or anything in months, so, you know, I don't remember beyond that, but they have done that and done that successfully. So.
And I looked it up when we had talked about it months ago, and it is out there. I think it is an Attorney General opinion, and I can look to see if I find I have that link saved and send it to you. But do you want to contact them?
So we
could see what their availability is, and then if the board can send dates.
Well, I would see the availability first,
mm-hmm.
and then let them tell us.
And then build it off of
yeah.
that. Okay.
Yep, we'll do that. We'll do that, and we can send how far out they are and what kind of timing they would be looking for and things
okay.
like that.
All right, so we have next steps on that. Jay will contact the Bureau, and then they'll let us know what their availability looks like, and then depending on that, we will put something on the books.
Is this something we can get, like, answers to tomorrow? I mean, do they have, I'm sure their schedule is pretty much set then.
So, Member Carl, Chair Cordes, we will contact them tomorrow.
Okay.
And then we'll kind of leave it up to them if they have to get back to us. They had some things in their department. Something happened to the kind of their top person, and that was several months ago. And so some of their things got pushed out farther. I don't know if they've restaffed now or things like that. But no, we'll contact them right away, and we'll, you know, let you know really soon, because this is a priority and something we want to have done. So we'll let them know we want it. It's a priority for us, and we want to get on their books as quick as we can.
Thank you. Mr. Chair, just to voice my opinion.
Yep.
If I had to choose between using the Bureau and having a retreat on our own, I'd prefer us having a retreat. I don't know if we need to have a closed session to figure things out, discuss the communication issues that we've been having. If it's communication protocols on how to work with the chair, if it's communication protocols on how to work with the superintendent, I think it's something that should be done at an open meeting. And it doesn't have to be a session where we're, you know, crying and moaning about things that have happened in the past. We don't need to do that. That's what the past retreats have done to some extent, and they have been productive. If we go in mind with a set goal and agenda of how we want to meet it and what our goals are, and what things, I don't think we need to have a let's all be on the same page, because we're never really going to all be on the same page. That's not the goal as a board in terms of
board members. Yes, there are things we need to do together, and as a board, we agree, yes, you know, when decisions are made, but we are going to have individual opinions. And I think for protocols of how to work together for communication, I don't think it's something we need to have the Bureau to come in and close a meeting for.
Thank you. Is there anybody else?
I guess if I mean, that's the route we go where it's just a retreat, I would vote that it's not recorded then.
I just think we need to move forward one way or the other and get this resolved. I mean, at this point, I'm willing to do whatever, but we got to move forward as adults here and get this resolved.
I would, at this point, just suggest let's take the first steps and see if they're available. If it turns out they're not available for 8 months, then let's look at doing a retreat. Does that make sense? If it's a resource, let's use it, in my opinion.
I'm fine however you want to go about it, but I think we need to do it sooner than later. I mean, I would say, you know what, if whatever you find out, Jay,
well, I'll text.
We can text determine you. Time yeah. frame and everything else. If it doesn't work out, we'll do something different, but we need to do something.
All right. Sounds good. More to come on that in the near future.
Thank you.
All right. That is the last item under discussion topics. Now we will move to administrative action. And the only item there is the approval of the bid for North Trail Elementary Fire Alarm System with Mr. Dan Miller.
Barbara, I just have to ask, are those your kids?
They are.
They're cute. It's been a nice little diversion.
Right. All right. Good evening again, Chair Cordes, members of the board, Superintendent Haugen, members of the audience. Just wanted to come before you this evening. We've talked about several times some of the work that we're doing in our buildings regarding fire alarm replacement. And we actually went out for a bid earlier this summer slash fall with North Trail, which is the last building in the district that we are looking to update and replace part of our systems there. Unfortunately, at that time, the bids did not come back favorable to the district, and so we opted not to take any of those and revisit with Hallberg Engineering, our consultant for all of the other fire alarm work that we've done, and see if we couldn't make some adjustments to the proposal and put it back out for bid and have it come back within budget. And so we did that, and as part of the packet, you can see there's a letter from Hallberg Engineering in there with our latest bid proposal, which came in last week on Tuesday. And if you take a look at it, what we were looking at in the budget was somewhere around $110,000. The base bid there came in at $133,900, but there is a deduct alternate bid. So there's a subtraction of a little over $26,000. And so the total amount of the low bid for ECSI systems integrators was just shy of $108,000. And so that second piece, that deduct alternate, was taking a look at what things we might be able to remove out of the scope of the work to get it to within budget. So for example, once again, it goes back to the piece that I mentioned before. When you start doing work, you know, you're held to current codes. Well, quite honestly, some of those current codes are to our favor. They don't require quite as many devices in buildings as to what they previously had. And so instead of replacing everything that's in the building, we're no longer held to that. And so actually we have fewer devices that we could put in. And that's, for all practical purposes, kind of what part of that deduct is. And then also along with that, then there's some wiring components and things that don't have to be replaced. So we were able to get that number down to what we had budgeted for originally. And so I guess, I don't know if there's any questions about that at all.
Chair, when you have a project like this and we're doing fewer devices, say, in the ceilings and whatnot, what is the, when the code changes, do you abandon in place the other ones that you're not replacing? Do they get tied in to the, how does that work?
So they wouldn't be tied in. So they would be removed. Because if they're there, they have to function.
Okay, and that was my question, was that I'd hate for us to have one sitting there and then people go, why is it not flashing or something?
Good question. Yep, they have, yep, they would have to be removed.
Okay, and that would be included in this?
Yes, so that's, yep.
Awesome.
That's part of the reason why, yep, that alternate bid deduct piece was to fewer devices and less wiring.
Thank you.
I guess if there are no questions, then it would be our recommendation to award the contract to ESCSI Systems Integrators in the amount of the $107,780.
Final questions? All right, I will take a motion.
I'll make a motion to award the low bidder for the replacement fire alarm systems at North Trail Elementary for ECSI Systems Integrators for $107,780.
Second.
Got a motion by Carrero, a second by Goodrow. Roll call vote, please.
Carrero?
Yes.
Doyle?
Yes.
Goodrow?
Yes.
Saucer?
Yes.
Singwald?
Yes.
Cordes?
Yes. Motion passes. Thank you. Last item tonight is a policy discussion. We've got two policies that are up for discussion with Ms. Barb Dufferin.
Close those. So we have two policies. Both are legislative changes, and so just some clarification. So the first one is policy 414, mandated reporting of child neglect or physical or sexual abuse, and there's an added definition in there that includes sex trafficking as part of sexual abuse. So it would seem it goes without saying, however, it is spelled out here in the policy. So that's the first change. Are there any questions on that? The second one is for a legislative change. It's for policy 509, enrollment of non-resident students, and it's simply an addition to the language around lotteries for open enrollment, and that children of the school district staff are part of the priority in the lottery.
Any questions?
Mr. Chair, so yep. Is that a statute change then?
This is all, yep, these are all coming through MSBA and statute change. I believe I looked that one up too to clarify that one.
Just to clarify, how have we been handling that such a scenario if it's been an issue within just current practice already?
That wasn't part of our policy previously, or it was? It was not. It was not part of our policy previously.
Do you think this will affect much with enrollment?
You know, I don't know that it will, but I can look to Jane and see if she has any speculation on that. I guess I wouldn't know.
I know in the past we've had a couple staff members that have had students coming in, you know, on the kindergarten level that we've, you know, they're very concerned about getting in and whatnot. And luckily, we've been able to accommodate them, but we do have that. We do have staff members that come from out of district that open enroll our students here, so it will affect. I mean, are we talking 20 slots? No, we're probably talking two or three.
Any other questions? All right, so these will come back to us next meeting for final reading.
If you're fine with just one more reading, I don't think this is a substantial change, and so it seems to me that we could just go with the second reading.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you. All right. Moving on to adjournment.
I'll make a motion to adjourn the meeting at 8:13.
Second.
Got a motion by Goodrow, a second by Doyle. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
And those opposed? We're adjourned.